What are the pros and cons of epinephrine?
Find out today on Medical History Mystery.
So we all use local anesthetics, and many of us choose to use local anesthetics that contain epinephrine for lots of reasons. And I know that it can have interactions with some medications and things like that, but I don't know if we have like a checklist in our brain as far as what's a pro and a con of epinephrine. And when we lesser known ways that we might be like, probably not the best choice.
Yep. So I think, you know, the issue with epinephrine is we view it sometimes as a friend and a foe, sort of a love-hate relationship. You know, we love the fact that epinephrine does one thing that for us that we can count on almost every time, which is by causing vasoconstriction, it increases the level of profound anesthesia we're able to accomplish. Okay. So the more times we use epinephrine, we lock the anesthetic in place, and therefore the anesthetic really can't leave, and that leads to that profound anesthesia. If you think about why epinephrine is required, though, it's because every local anesthetic, when you inject it in the mucosa, causes vasodilation. And vasodilation means the anesthetic leaves the area too quickly, ends up in your brain and your heart, on some of the more highly vascular organs, causing side effects. And the space is filled with blood, right? Because bleeding now is possible. So epinephrine wipes all that out. It locks the anesthetic in so the anesthetic can't leave, right? The little that does get out doesn't really affect your organs as much, and blood can't enter to backfill the space. So again, win-win-win for us. That's the love part, right? The hate part is, what does it do after it's done with us? So when the anesthesia leaves, right, when the anesthesia wears off, where does it go? Well, anesthesia goes to more highly vascular organs, brain and heart. So does the epinephrine, causing side effects. And one of the things we know for sure is tachycardia, right, from epinephrine. So that's not making us very happy. The love part comes back again, let's say, with epinephrine and EpiPens. Right, you have a peanut allergy and end up eating an errant peanut, give yourself a stick with a self-auto injector with epinephrine in it, and you can literally cause bronchodilation that overrides the bronchoconstriction of anaphylaxis, so saving your own life. And we also have the hate come back again, because if you use long needles or if you somehow manage to inject anesthesia with epinephrine into muscle, it can cause vasodilation. Counterintuitive, right? It's a vasoconstrictor, but in muscle, it can cause vasodilation. And that can lead to things like trismus, hematoma, bleeding, that sort of thing. So I guess the best way to look at epinephrine is it's got benefits, it's got risks. So which way should we go? What should we do? Does the benefit outweigh the risk? And I think in dentistry, we often see that we believe the benefit outweighs the risk, because we can manage the risks pretty much with injection technique, and when knowing exactly which anesthetic agent to use. Downside of epinephrine, if anything, is that medical doctors often say, don't use epi. And when you don't use epi, you lose all of the benefits, as we just discussed.
Especially when you have a procedure that's going to last a little while. So endo, crown prep, or even sometimes after extractions, you want to give an extra injection of like a Marcaine or something that's going to last a while to help with the analgesic effect. So we have to weigh out the pros and the cons. And I think you're right. In many instances, the pros outweigh the cons. And it also reminds us that we have to use proper injection technique. So aspirate your syringes. And mm-hmm. If you're not sure of a technique, take a course and follow up and, you know, and make sure that you're comfortable with the technique that you're using. If you're not comfortable handling the complications of a procedure, maybe you shouldn't be doing that procedure. That's kind of words I live by.
Yeah. And honestly, you know, a lot of doctors, medical doctors, don't see that the whole point is moot. If you, let's say you decide to use bupivacaine, and so there's no epi, right? The anesthesia lasts about 45 minutes, if you're lucky, sometimes less, sometimes 40 minutes. The patient was profoundly anesthetized. Now they're no longer anesthetized after that 40 minutes. They start to feel the pain. that when they start to feel the pain, that sensation causes immediately what? That burst of endogenous epinephrine from their adrenal glands. Now, ow, I felt that. Okay, so what do you do? Oh, you felt that? Let me give you more. The minute they see the syringe in your hand, that's more endogenous epinephrine because it makes them nervous. Then you give them the injection that hurts, more endogenous epinephrine. And then you're just sitting there waiting for the anesthesia to wear off because it wore off the first time. And that's even more endogenous epinephrine. So you can make the argument that the patient would have received less epi if you just used epi in the first place.
If you just gave them epi in the first place. All right. Well, to me, it sounds like the benefits outweigh the cons for sure. Obviously, the cons are there, but if, you know, maybe if you use proper technique and, you know, a judicious use of your epinephrine, hopefully you won't see those cons as readily. Well, Tom, this was a medical history mystery that I think was a pretty easy one to solve. What do you think?
I think we're going to leave this with a cliffhanger. How about that, Pam? We're going to lead into our next medical history mysteries with this cliffhanger. Ready? Don't forget about the sulfites. But I'll leave that for our next episode.
Sulfites. Wow. All right. Join us next week. Learn about the sulfites. See you then.
All right, buddy.